Welcome to Moman's Orthodox Presbyterian Church, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Just a few announcements. The offerings today are for General Fund and for the Moman's Food Pantry. My family and I will be on vacation next week. Not this coming week, but the week after. And so this next Sunday, we'll have Mr. Nathaniel, and I have no idea how to pronounce his last name, but I'm going to go with Blershel. But it could be local, or could be a number of other things. But I would appreciate your correction of my pronunciation and asking him next week how his name is pronounced. But he will be filling pulpit next Sunday morning and evening. A couple of thank yous from Ann Beeshold and the Kistlers also, and the golf outing of Mid-America Seminary is still open, and you can register for that if golf's your thing. And also Elam's announcement about the No Festival Dutch Festival is also in the bulletin too. Also, we'll be praying for Mr. Everett Sherman this morning. He'll be having an operation this week, so please keep him in your prayers. Let's prepare our hearts and minds now for the worship of the living God with a time of silent prayer. Stand for our call to worship from Psalm 44. We have heard with our ears, O God. Our fathers have told us what you did in their days, in days long ago. With your hand you drove out the nations and planted our fathers. You crushed the peoples and made our fathers flourish. It was not by their sword that they won the land, nor did their arm bring them victory. It was your right hand, your arm, and the light of your face. For you loved them. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be present in our midst this morning. Please turn with me to number 184, the hymnal, The King of Love, My Shepherd Is, 184.
The King of Love, My Shepherd Is.
For our encouragement for Christian living, we come to Article 10 of the Belgic Confession, which tells us of the true, full divinity of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is in the context of an explanation of the doctrine of the Trinity. And, of course, as part of that, we affirm that the Father is fully God, the Son is fully God, the Holy Spirit is fully God. So in this, Jesus Christ is full and eternal God. Now, there's one word in this that we don't use very often, and that's effulgence, which means a bright, it's like the rays of the sun that come from the sun, and they shine very brightly. And so he's called it the image or substance and effulgence of the glory of the Father. And this is picking up on the language of Hebrews chapter 1, which talks about Jesus being the exact imprint of the Father's nature. So this is Article 10, Jesus Christ is true and eternal God. We believe that Jesus Christ, according to his divine nature, is the only begotten Son of God, begotten from eternity, not made, nor created, for then he would be a creature, but co-essential and co-eternal with the Father, the very image of his substance and the effulgence of his glory, equal unto him in all things. He is the Son of God, not only from the time that he assumed our nature, but from all eternity, as these testimonies, when compared together, teach us. Moses says that God created the world, and St. John says all things were made by that word which he calls God. The Apostle says that God made the world by his Son. Likewise, that God created all things by Jesus Christ. Therefore, it must needs follow that he who is called God, the Word, the Son, and Jesus Christ, did exist at that time when all things were created by him. Therefore, the prophet Micah says, his goings forth are from of old, from everlasting. And the apostle, he hath neither beginning of days nor end of life. He therefore is that true, eternal, and almighty God whom we invoke, worship, and serve. Please turn with me to hymn number 188, Jesus, I am resting, resting, 188.
Oh,
expository reading this morning, we come to Deuteronomy chapter 1. This is mostly a historical chapter. Moses is recounting the history of the people with God, history that they have all lived through. So he's not reminding them of past history, but of their own history. And he's not doing this primarily to shame them, though it might appear that way at first glance, because he does remind them of their failings. What he's doing here instead is that he's reminding them of what they need to learn from their history. As the old saying goes, if you can't remember the past, you're condemned to repeat it. And he doesn't want them repeating the mistakes of the past, so he's reminding them that they're still God's people despite these failings in the past, and that they shouldn't fall prey to those mistakes of the past that they committed. So this is the word of our God, Deuteronomy chapter 1. These are the words Moses spoke to all Israel in the desert east of the Jordan, that is in the Arabah, opposite Suf, between Paran and Tophel, Laban, Hazeroth, and Dizahab. It takes 11 days to go from Horeb to Kadesh Barnea by the Mount Seir road. In the 40th year, on the first day of the 11th month, Moses proclaimed to the Israelites all that the Lord commanded him concerning them. This was after he had defeated Sihon, king of the Amorites, who reigned in Heshbon, and at Edrei had defeated Og, king of Bashan, who reigned in Ashtaroth. East of the Jordan in the territory of Moab, Moses began to expound this law, saying, "The Lord our God said to us at Horeb, you have stayed long enough at this mountain. Break camp and advance into the hill country of the Amorites. Go to all the neighboring peoples in the Arabah, in the mountains, in the western foothills, in the Negev and along the coast, to the land of the Canaanites and to Lebanon as far as the great river, the Euphrates. See, I have given you this land. Go in and take possession of the land that the Lord swore he would give to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and to their descendants after them. At that time I said to you, you are too heavy a burden for me to carry alone. The Lord your God has increased your numbers, so that today you are as many as the stars in the sky. May the Lord, the God of your fathers, increase you 1,000 times, and bless you as he has promised. But how can I bear your problems and your burdens and your disputes all by myself? Choose some wise, understanding, and respected men from each of your tribes, and I will set them over you. You answered me, what you propose to do is good. So I took the leading men of your tribes, wise and respected men, and appointed them to have authority over you, as commanders of thousands, of hundreds, of fifties, and of tens, and as tribal officials. And I charged your judges at that time, hear the disputes between your brothers and judge fairly, whether the case is between brother Israelites or between one of them and an alien. Do not show partiality in judging, hear both small and great alike. Do not be afraid of any man, for judgment belongs to God. Bring me any case too hard for you, and I will hear it. And at that time I told you everything you were to do. Then, as the Lord our God commanded us, we set out from Horeb and went toward the hill country of the Amorites, through all that vast and dreadful desert that you have seen. And so we reached Kadesh Barnea. Then I said to you, we have reached the hill country of the Amorites, which the Lord our God has given us. See, the Lord your God has given you the land. Go up and take possession of it, as the Lord, the God of your fathers, told you. Do not be afraid, do not be discouraged. Then all of you came to me and said, let us send men ahead to spy out the land for us and bring back a report about the route we are to take and the towns we will come to. The idea seemed good to me, so I selected 12 of you, one man from each tribe. They left and went up into the hill country and came to the valley of Eshcol and explored it. Taking with them some of the fruit of the land, they brought it down to us and reported, it is a good land that the Lord our God is giving us. But you were unwilling to go up. You rebelled against the command of the Lord your God. You grumbled in your tents and said, the Lord hates us. So he brought us out of Egypt to deliver us into the hands of the Amorites to destroy us. Where can we go? Our brothers have made us lose heart. They say, the people are stronger and taller than we are. The cities are large, with walls up to the sky. We even saw the Anakites there. Then I said to you, do not be terrified. Do not be afraid of them. The Lord your God, who is going before you, will fight for you, as he did for you in Egypt, before your very eyes, and in the desert. There you saw how the Lord your God carried you, as a father carries his son, all the way you went, until you reached this place. In spite of this, you did not trust in the Lord your God, who went ahead of you on your journey in fire by night, and in a cloud by day, to search out places for you to camp, and to show you the way you should go. When the Lord heard what you said, he was angry and solemnly swore, "Not a man of this evil generation shall see the good land I swore to give your forefathers, except Caleb, son of Jephunneh. He will see it, and I will give him and his descendants the land he set his feet on, because he followed the Lord wholeheartedly. Because of you, the Lord became angry with me also, and said, 'You shall not enter it either. But your assistant, Joshua son of Nun, will enter it. Encourage him, because he will lead Israel to inherit it. And the little ones that you said would be taken captive, your children who do not yet know good from bad, they will enter the land. I will give it to them, and they will take possession of it. But as for you, turn around and set out toward the desert along the route to the Red Sea.' Then you replied, 'We have sinned against the Lord. We will go up and fight as the Lord our God commanded us.' So every one of you put on his weapons, thinking it easy to go up into the hill country. The Lord said to me, 'Tell them, do not go up and fight, because I will not be with you. You will be defeated by your enemies.' So I told you, but you would not listen. You rebelled against the Lord's command, and in your arrogance, you marched up into the hill country. The Amorites who lived in those hills came out against you. They chased you like a swarm of bees, and beat you down from Seir all the way to Hormah. You came back and wept before the Lord, but he paid no attention to your weeping and turned a deaf ear to you. And so you stayed in Kadesh many days, all the time you spent there." Let us turn to the Lord our God in prayer. O great and eternal triune God, you are great beyond our reckoning. You are great in your eternal nature. You are great in that you are wholly different, completely different from your creation. And Father, you are great in your creative power, for you have created all the things that we see, and you've created all the things that we can't see. You've created all of these and given us, Father, a home, a beautiful home. For you loved us, Father. You set your love upon us. You gave us what we needed. We had all we needed in the Garden of Eden, Father. But in Adam, Father, we decided we needed more. And we decided to rebel against you. We decided we wanted to be on the throne of the universe and be the captains of our own souls. And so, Father, we rebelled and lost our relationship, our favor with you. But, Father, you did not abandon us to eternal condemnation as you could justly have done. But you showed forth then your redemptive, saving love. And that is a love beyond our comprehension, Father. For we were rebels. We were your enemies. But you sent your son to die for his enemies. And so you turned us from enemies into not only friends, but adopted children within your family. And so your love, Father, knows no boundaries in its power and in its depth. Father, we acknowledge it before you today and praise you for it. For Father, your qualities are often set against each other by people of this world. And people often talk about your justice as if you can't also be loving and kind. But we know, Father, the scripture portrays you as both just and merciful, punishing sin but also forgiving sin. And we thank you that in Jesus Christ we have not only the forgiveness of sins, but the eternal love bestowed upon us in history. We thank you and praise you for this, Father, for we can only come before you in worship if we have been forgiven for our sins. And we ask for that forgiveness, for we acknowledge our sin before you, that it is of a piece with Adam's sin, that corruption passed down to us is what creates actual sin in our own lives. But all of that you have forgiven in Jesus. And so, Father, we ask for that faith that lays hold of Christ and all of his benefits, so that we will grow in our understanding of just how much you have done for us, and how much you have loved us, and from all eternity how you have loved us. But Lord God, we pray for a world which does not seem to know what love is. A world that is dying. A world that is angry, but doesn't even know what it's angry about. Doesn't even know that it's dying. Doesn't even know what sin is. And Father, does not acknowledge you as Lord and Savior. And so, Father, we pray for that dying world. We pray that we might show the love of Christ to them. We pray, Father, that we would be people of prayer, a church of prayer. That we would pray for opportunities to tell people about Jesus. We would pray for opportunities to meet people's needs so that they will see love, even though we might not have a personal relationship with them yet. We pray, Father, for you to help us to love our enemies and to pray for those who persecute us. We pray for the persecuted church in the world today. We know, Father, that people are dying for their faith. And we pray that your love will hold them firm, hold their confession firm, so that their sacrifice will be noticed and people will see that this is a faith worth dying for. We pray, Father, for our church, for its members, for spiritual growth and wisdom. And we pray, Father, for those who are going to undergo operations. I pray for Mr. Sherman this morning. We're thankful for successful operations, and in the case of Mr. Bill Sherman and Mrs. Lucille Sherman. And we pray, Father, for those who are experiencing anxiety or pain. And we ask that you will bless them with your goodness, that they will see your love. We pray, Father, for our worship this morning, that it may be acceptable in your sight, that you will receive it and bless us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please turn with me to number 189 in the hymnal, Jesus Loves Me, This I Know. 189, we'll stand and sing together.
Jesus loves me, this I know, Lord God, I know.
be seated. I just saw something in that hymn that I'd like to point out, and that is the importance of a comma. In the last verse it says, if I love him, comma, when I die he will take me home on high. But a lot of people sing it, if I love him when I die, comma, he will take me home on high. Those are very different things. The comma comes after if I love him. And of course, we can only love him if he's first loved us. But the importance of a comma. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for your word, for your revelation to us, and for your promise that you, the Holy Spirit will lead us into all truth. We pray for his help today and ask that you will bless our hearts and minds with your truth so that we will believe and obey your word. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to turn to Romans chapter 5, where we'll read verses 6 through 8. Probably actually best to start at the beginning of the chapter, so we'll start at verse 1 of chapter 5. This is the holy, inspired, and inerrant word of God. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The pastor R. Kent Hughes tells this Revolutionary War story about a faithful minister of the gospel by the name of Peter Miller. He lived near a fellow who hated him intensely for his Christian life and testimony. In fact, this man violently opposed him and ridiculed his followers. Well, one day the unbeliever was found guilty of treason and was sentenced to death. Hearing about this, Peter Miller set out on foot to intercede for the man's life before George Washington. General Washington listened to the minister's earnest plea, but told him he didn't feel he should pardon Peter Miller's friend. My friend? He is not my friend, answered Miller. In fact, he's my worst living enemy. What? Said Washington. You've walked 60 miles to save the life of your enemy? Well, that, in my judgment, puts the matter in a different light. I will grant your request. So with pardon in hand, Miller hastened to the place where his neighbor was to be executed and arrived just as the prisoner was walking to the scaffold. When the traitor saw Miller, he exclaimed, "Old Peter Miller has come to have his revenge by watching me hang." But he was astonished as he saw the minister step out of the crowd and produce the pardon which saved his life. Now that's a pretty amazing story, isn't it? The lengths to which Peter Miller went to save his enemy are quite remarkable. And there is an illustrative biblical story that's like this, the story of the Good Samaritan. The power of that story hinges on the fact that Jews and Samaritans were mortal enemies to each other. And Jesus used that story to demonstrate that, lo and behold, your neighbors are not all friendly to you. But we're still required to love our neighbor. And that's also a remarkable story, isn't it? But you know, you could still only really describe that kind of action as the height of human love. And that doesn't even begin to describe the depth of divine love towards us. Because you see, in neither of these examples did the person die for his enemy. He showed great kindness, a spirit of forgiveness, which is completely admirable, but that still only gives us a beginning glimpse into what the divine love is like. And that's what Paul's trying to do for us in this passage. Show us the amazing dimensions of divine love. At this point in Paul's letter, Paul is trying to give us the assurance of salvation. How can we know that we are saved people? That's Paul's entire point for chapters 5 through 8. And notice verse 5, which says that God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. And then in verses 6 through 8, our passage, he's going to describe the nature of that love. It is a very great help to our assurance to know how deep that love goes. In fact, it doesn't matter how deep the love of God has to go. We know it could go much further if it needed to in order to get to us. The love of God has, in fact, gone into the very depths of hell to rescue us, to get us out of there. So this revelation of the love of God is key to our assurance. How much does God love us? It doesn't seem to have any limits in the Bible. And that's one of the biggest limitations, shall we say, of Christian life. The limitation that we as finite creatures cannot grasp the dimensions of the love of God. And that simultaneously is one of the great glories of the next life. Because though we'll still never come to the end of that love, we'll start seeing a lot more of it. So Paul starts the passage by telling us about the timing of the love of God. The NIV translates it very well here, at just the right time. And there's two ideas embedded in that phrase. The first is that it was the time in human history when God appointed his love to appear in the person and work of Jesus Christ. But the second idea is that it was the optimum time for God's love to show forth. It's no accident, then, that the appointed time is also the best time. And what is that time? What's the key characteristic of that time? Well, Paul describes it as the time when we were still powerless. God doesn't want us to start thinking that we could save ourselves. So he sent his son at a time when we had absolutely no power to save ourselves. Now, you could say, well, that's all of human history, isn't it? Well, certainly. Certainly it was. But this is the time because there were other factors involved for why God sent his son at that exact time. But at this point, Paul's point is that we were powerless. The human race is powerless. And it's powerless. It became more obvious at this time because, you see, you've got this Roman Empire that wants to rule everything. And it's talking about power all the time. But the contrast between this kind of secular power and a religious power, a theoretical religious power to save oneself, is very stark, isn't it? Doesn't matter how much human power you might have in the Roman Empire, that's not going to do anything to save people from their worst enemies. just in case we miss the point, Paul says, Christ died for the ungodly. You see, in America today, in many churches, we think that Christ died for the good people. Christ died for the worthy people. Of course, Paul has spent an enormous amount of time in Romans proving that there is no such person. There is no one who does good, no, not even one, in Romans 3. He says it about 15 times, because that is something our human nature just does not want to acknowledge. Every person is a sinner, every person is ungodly, and therefore every person needs that death and resurrection of Christ to apply to him in order to obtain salvation. And now Paul tells us how far this love of God goes. He gives us two examples of people that human beings might possibly love. The first is in the first part of verse 7. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man. What does Paul mean by the righteous man? Not someone who's righteous by faith in this context, but the person who dots his I's and crosses his T's. A regular little Pharisee, this person is. Now, how often would you say that anyone would die for a person like that? We come to the same conclusion Paul does, very rarely. Now, such a person has redeeming qualities. Obeying the rules is not necessarily a bad thing. In fact, it's usually a very good thing. And yet, that doesn't really seem to engage people's affections all that much. How lovable is the rule keeper? Not always very lovable, as it turns out, even though that person may have a very admirable character. So what about the second person? Paul describes him in the second half of verse 7. Paul describes him as a good man. Well, that's a bit better, isn't it? The good man is not only someone who likes to obey the rules like the righteous person, but he goes beyond that. The good person also loves other people and does good things for them. He's a benevolent person. He's a benefactor. And that person's much easier to love, isn't he? In fact, it'd be easy enough to love such a person well enough to die for him. A good example of this is the story told by Charles Dickens in his book A Tale of Two Cities. Charles Darnay is the good man, noble man, generous in his kindness to people. Sidney Carton, on the other hand, lived a reckless life of alcoholism. He might have made something of his life, but he didn't. They both loved the same woman, Lucy Manette, who winds up marrying Charles Darnay, the good man. And Sidney Carton was somewhat bitter about that, but he recognizes that she's very happy in her marriage to Charles Darnay. And this is said at the time of the French Revolution. Charles Darnay, the good man, is tricked into going into France so that he can be picked up as a traitor to France, because his father, Evremond, was a notorious aristocrat who cared nothing for the lives of others. And just as Darnay is condemned, Sidney Carton decides to take his place. And with great ingenuity, he does so and suffers the guillotine in place of Charles Darnay, so Darnay can go back to his wife and child. Now, that's an example of this second thing that Paul is talking about here, right? For a good man, someone might possibly dare to die. But you see, that doesn't get at the depth of God's love either. Because that's an example of someone dying for a lovable person. It's easy in the story, when you read it, to love Charles Darnay and Lucy Manette. They're such admirable characters, full of love and kindness. But as Paul says, that doesn't get at the depth of the love of God either. And what about the two stories we started off with? Peter Miller and the Good Samaritan. They didn't attain to the level of the love of God, as admirable as their actions and love were. You see, they showed kindness to their enemies, but they still didn't pay the ultimate price for their enemies. Neither of them laid down their lives for the enemy, but that's exactly what Jesus did. Verse 8 says it like this: God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Notice a couple things about this verse. Notice the presence of God the Father. It's the Father's love that is demonstrated in this verse. The love of the Father. The same love that we see in John 3:16. God, who is the Father in that verse, loved the world in this way, that he sent his Son. So we're talking about the love of God the Father for sinners. Now, of course, the love of Jesus the Son for us is just as great. In fact, it is the same love. We should never think that the Son had to convince an unwilling Father that he could save us. It's the love of God that is characteristic of both of them for their people. That love is as deep as time, as wide as the ocean, stronger than the foundations of the earth. And notice, secondly, that God did not wait for us to become lovable people before he loved us. Instead, his love changes us into lovable people. We cannot think that God loves us because we're so lovable. We're just a cut above our neighbor. There's just something inside us that makes God love us more. The only thing that can make us lovable is God's love. To die for one's enemies. God's plan, of course, is to change us. But don't miss the extent of a love that will send someone to die for the worst enemy they've got. That's not a human love. That's divine. That is totally beyond our comprehension. Cannot fathom it. It should make us be very wary about how we treat people who are not part of the church. Because we often think to ourselves, that kind of person doesn't deserve to come to this church or fellowship with other people, that person's a scumbag. But God's grace comes first, doesn't it? That's what changes us. And we forget how God has dealt with us when we say that that person needs to clean their act up before they come and join us. We should not be thinking that way. C.S. Lewis wrote a book entitled Surprised by Joy, which is his autobiography. In that book, Lewis described his spiritual journey. He went everywhere but Christianity. He was pursuing this idea of joy, which was a stab of almost painful joy. He got it only very occasionally, and he didn't recognize it for what it was until he had exhausted every opportunity of trying to find it. In the last chapter of the book, called Checkmate, he describes his conversion in terms of God literally dragging him, kicking and screaming, into the kingdom of God. And he writes about the love of God at that time. Lewis says, "How could we duly admire someone who loved me enough to put me into the kingdom, despite the fact that I was kicking and screaming and fleeing everywhere for a chance of escape?" My father's conversion story, very similar to C.S. Lewis. You can't talk about that chapter of Lewis's book without crying. And he remarked how powerful the love of God was, because it was powerful enough to overcome the strongest possible barriers that he put up to the love of God. And believe me, a Scotsman like my father could put up some rather serious barriers. But that's nothing to the love of God. You could find the same idea in Francis Thompson's poem, The Hound of Heaven. The poet starts out saying, I fled him down the nights and down the days. I fled him down the arches of the years. But he could do nothing to shake off this heavenly pursuer. And the Hound of Heaven tells him, no one will love him save the Hound of Heaven himself. And all things are worthless until the love of God rests on him. The man kept on thinking he'd have to give up everything if God got a hold of him. And in the end, he found out that he had nothing to give up and everything to gain by being claimed by the Hound of Heaven. It's a wonderful poem about the depth of the love of God. How far will God go to save a person? Hell itself. That's how far he'll go. So as that love consumed us, as it pursued us, have we seen its power and depth at work in our lives? Just want to say this again. Our tiny capacity to understand the love of God is probably the greatest liability that we have as Christians. In Ephesians, Paul puts it like this. I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power. And notice that it requires power in the Christian life, together with all the saints, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. That takes power from God in the Christian life to understand even the beginnings of the dimensions of the love of God. Do we pray for that power? Do we long for it? Unfortunately, we're often so small in our ability to comprehend it. We have such small vessels that we can only hold a tiny bit of that incredible love. The larger our souls, the more love from God they will hold. And it's God who can give us larger souls. There's nothing so stupendous as the love of God. We love talking about it sometimes, but we don't understand it. It's beyond our dreams. And why is that? Because God himself could be described as love. God is love, John tells us. The love of God is as astounding and powerful as God himself. Maybe some of us have never known great love. Maybe our parents didn't really give it to us. Maybe we haven't found it in relationships. Maybe we've never had a great friend. Maybe there's a void there, a vacuum that we try to fill with whatever we can. And we can become desperate about that sometimes because human souls want love. But there's nothing that will fill that void like the love of Christ can. The love of God can make that void look like a little tiny crack. It can fill it up completely and overflow. We need God to fill us. And if he fills us, we will be overflowing. It will run over. It'll keep running over until it spills out into the lives of the people around us. We can't help that even. That's the love of God working. So some of us, all of us, in fact, need to pray that the Lord will open up our souls, broaden our souls, to receive that incredible love of God, that healing, transforming, gracious love. He died for his enemies. And even while he was on the cross, he prayed that the Father would forgive those who were crucifying him. Now, how can we know that God loves us? Well, as we sang, the Bible tells us so. But we can also know it because of the changes it brings. How could anyone be filled with that love without seeing amazing changes in their lives? If God's love can turn hell itself inside out, then it can certainly change us. May that love take hold of us in all of its depth, breadth, height, and width. Let's pray. O Lord God, your love is beyond our comprehension. And we are amazed that you would set it upon us who were your enemies. We're thankful that you have now changed us. Continue changing us by your love. But especially, Father, help us to grasp more of these dimensions of your love. That it requires power in us, we acknowledge. Not a power we have in and of ourselves. But Father, help us. Give us that power. So that we will have more of your love. And can show that love more clearly to others. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Please turn with me to hymn number 708. O love that wilt not let me go. 708. We'll stand and sing together.
God's blessing and benediction. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.